Hello everyone and welcome back to another video. So today we've got another So You Want to Play episode and we have the polls for this week. And you guys were requesting the new civs because you wanted to play them. And I figured I released two build orders for the polls and the Bohemians in my Discord available for subscribers to my Twitch stream. I figured I want to also do a So You Want to Play around the same time just to kind of synergize well and help you guys play the new civs. Without further ado, let's hop into it. So the Poles, they're described as a cavalry civilization. If you guys are new to the So You Want to Play series, I'm going to take a look at the Civ in detail in a theoretical perspective. Then I'm going to showcase a game that I've played with them on the rank ladder and then show you guys a practical perspective and compare the two to see how they play out. So the Poles are described as a cavalry civilization, but they're a lot more than that. Villagers regenerate 5 HP per minute in Dark Age, 10 in Feudal and 15 in Castle, 20 in Imp. This is just a bonus that helps not lose vills to raids and helps in the early game to not lose vills to or have weak vills because you took damage to boar. Small thing that helps, but nothing too crazy. Often forgotten. The Folwark replaces the mill. Folwark, we'll get into it a little bit later as to what it is. Stone miners generate gold in addition to stone. This happens as a trickle and it's 50% of the stone you gather. You get it as instant gold like a relic per villager. Very strong bonus. Probably one of the best eco bonuses in the game, I might say. Definitely the Poles' best bonus, though. So unique in it is the Obich, which is an infantry, and then they also get the Winged Hussar, which is a cavalry, which is just instead of the Hussar upgrade. The unique tech is the Slasher privileges, which gives knights minus 60% gold. This sounds really good on paper, but it's actually not that good in practice. It has some plays, it's definitely not bad, but it's not as good as you might think it is, so I'll talk about that a little bit later. And then their Lychitic Legacy, I'm probably butchering these names, gives their light cavalry trample damage, which is like the cat effect, light cav, hussar, and scout cav in Imperial Age, which is very interesting. So that's definitely not too bad. And their team bonus is that scout cavalry, light cavalry, and hussar have plus one attack versus archers, which definitely does come up as well. All right, cool. So if you take a look at their tech tree now, oh my god, this cough is disastrous. I hope you guys don't mind. So if you take a look at the tech tree now, they've got fully upgraded Arbalest. They've got skirmishers, they've got heavy cav archers, missing Parthian tactics, no hand cannons though. Going to their barracks, they've got fully upgraded champions with artisan supplies, no halberdier, must be noted. And then for their cavalry, they have the winged hussar and the cavalier, no paladin. That's kind of one of the reasons why their Castle unique tech is not that good, because they're missing paladin. But winged hussar is definitely not too bad. It's a good replacement for the hussar and gets them a little bit of extra stats. It's actually plus 2 attack, plus 5 HP, and plus 1 melee armor. It costs slightly more than the Hussar upgrade though, so it's a little bit more expensive. And they get Bloodline Husbandry. For their Siege Workshop, they have Siege Rams, Onagers, and Bomber Cannons. I guess Bomber Cannon and Siege Ram are like the two main choices. The Blacksmith is a little bit lacking though. I said it's fully upgraded Arbalest, I was mistaken. They're actually lacking the Ring Archer armor. And they're lacking the Plate Barding armor, which is very interesting. This is what makes their Ring Hussar and their Cavalier play not that good, especially against Archer Civs. So my best advice is only go for the Cavalier play against Cav Civs, because against Archer Civs, you're going to get roasted in the Imperial Age without this Plate Barding. If you do decide to go for their Cav play with unique tech or you know Knight play, try to end the game in Castle Age versus Archer Civs. If they go to Imperial Age, they're going to just shred your cavalry because you don't have the last armor. So definitely keep that in mind. Winged Hussar are still decent in Imp, even against Archer Civs, because if you can get close, you do trample damage and you also get the extra plus one attack. So Winged Hussar are like pretty good versus Archer Civs, but it's definitely not as good as you might think it is. Water, they get Galleon with Bracer, and they get fast fire ships, nothing too crazy. University, they're missing Siege Engineer, so the Bomber Cannon is nothing that crazy. They do get Bomber Tower and Keep, which is nice though. And then their Obich is a unique unit, costs 55 food and 20 gold. This is actually a little bit overtuned at this point. Maybe not overtuned, but definitely a strong unit. And I would say that it's definitely one of their go-to options if you can't play the Cavalry. So Obich, it actually has a unique thing where when it attacks, it destroys the enemy armor. So it will lose, like if it hits a unit, the enemy unit loses one armor of melee and one armor of pierce. Until they get to zero armor, it doesn't go into the negatives. And I was told that if you heal up that unit, if the enemy heals up that unit, it gets the armor back. If not, then it will stay with no armor forever, pretty much. So Obich in combination with archers can be a really good combination. You shred the pierce armor, and then you destroy the enemy with the Arbalest in the backline, for example. But that army composition is very hard to get to. But in general, the Obich is very tanky. This is elite stats. 95 HP with elites, 10 base attack, 2 plus 2 armor. And it's a pretty cheap upgrade, and it's a pretty cheap unit. So Overall, it's pretty solid. And I'm struggling with this cough, and I'm trying my best. Going to the monastery, they got redemption. Oh, they get hoardings, I guess it's worth mentioning. Redemption and sanctity and block printing. So they get the important text in the monastery. Not bad. Not a great, but not bad. And then eco upgrades are definitely there. So that's a pretty good overview of the polls. Just to quickly recap, I'm sorry if I went too quickly in certain parts. Just to quickly recap, their best bonuses is definitely making use of the full work. Oh, we didn't touch the full work, actually. Let's go back in the tech tree. My apologies. Full work is here. So it costs 125 wood. And essentially what it is simply just a building that's a mill plus a house in one. It costs the same. It gives you 5 population space. The only bonus it gives you past the 5 population space, which is covered in the cost, is simply that the farms you make near it, 10% of the food that you make or that farm has, you get instantly as food. So it's really good to get great farms around this, and it's really good in the early game, but also in the late game. So getting crop rotation with poles is really good for late game, and you farm around the full work. I think most of your farms should be around full works. Don't be afraid to make multiple in Castle Age, for example. It's definitely one of their better bonuses as well. And it's also 3x3, so it's easy to place farms around it. So it's really good for those reasons. So yeah, it gives you 10% of the farm's food instantly when you produce it. So if you have a regular farm, it gives you 17.5. Horse collar farms will give you 25 because they have 250 total. So that's pretty much that. So yeah, let's hop into now a game that I have played with the polls. Let me go ahead and take a look here. It's actually in single player, load game. I just played it, so it's fresh. It's going to be me versus MBL. Let's hop into this one and let's take a look. I'm going to actually load up cap trades here real quick. Should have had this prepared earlier, but it shouldn't take too long. All right. Okay. All right. So it should be good now. Awesome. So this is a game I played not too long ago. It is a replay, of course, but it's definitely an interesting one. It's between me and MBL, so we have, let's put me in the blue. Can I change that? Let's see if I can change that from in-game. Oh, it is, I am in the blue in-game. How does that work? Okay, I'm gonna be in the red, I guess. Am I really not allowed to change that? All right, well, I'm new with capture, so excuse me for that, but I'll be in the red, it's okay. So you have me in the red, Hera playing as the Poles, and I'm in the west of the map, and then to the east of the map, we've got MBL playing in blue, and he is playing as the Cumans. So automatically, what we need to see is just think of the matchup as usual. Now, the Poles bonuses that I want to use is the stone. So I want to make sure to mine a lot of stone, because you get a trickle of gold, and stone can be used to put towers forward, maybe castles. I might consider a full calf play using the Castleage Union Attack and Castleage. However, as I said, that's kind of not the best, simply because you don't have good armor in Imperial Age for your calf. And also, getting the tech is very expensive. You have to make a castle, firstly. Then you have to get the tech, which costs quite a lot. And then you have to also pump out knights. And they only cost minus 60% gold. Doesn't touch the food cost. So while that might seem like you're saving a lot of gold, you are. But it's still very expensive to get there, and it doesn't pay back fast enough. So that is the reason why I don't think that tech is very good. So I want to stay away from that if possible. It's only good in certain situations, and I don't want to make that part of my game plan going into the game. So I want to generally just go for anything that makes use of the stone and the full work, which gives me a good food boost and good stone and gold economy. So my plan is to go for a Men-at-Arm Tower Rush. Now, I did this partly because someone donated 10 subs to the stream and asked to see the strategy, and also because I had showcased this in my Discord as a build order for subscribers to the stream as well, so it's very relevant. I'm pushing in a deer, it's not necessary, and this guy goes back, that's bad. I actually messed up the build order a little bit here, so if you're following the Discord guide version of it, that one is more correct than this. This one is a bit more of an improvised one. And I get off to a pretty rough start build order-wise. But otherwise, it's fine. I push the deer in, and I'm ready to go. My opponent here is the Cumans. So if we think about the matchup, Cumans have a few options. They can go for the 2TC in Feudal Age, which is definitely very strong, but also risky. Men-at-Arm Tower can really punish that. So I'm kind of hoping he goes for the 2TC boom, because I can punish that with Men-at-Arm Tower. That being said, Cumans have also other options, which are just going scouts or archers, because their buildings cost less wood. So Cumans are definitely a bit tricky these days after their recent buffs. So we'll keep an eye on what he decides to do. But definitely if it goes 2TC boom, I could be in a good position to punish him with a Tower Rush. And generally speaking, the Tower Rush involves Men-at-Arms. The reason you want to go Men-at-Arms with a Pole Tower Rush is simply because you want to invest your wood into farms. So you don't want to invest into like an archer range or into a stable to follow up a regular Tower Rush. You really want to just invest into one barrack which is cheap on the wood. That gets you a unit and you don't need to invest into another building. So you just invest the rest of the wood into farms around the full work to develop your economy and hopefully get you to castle age at a very good time. I'm going to be using a lot of my stone piles, so keep an eye on that for sure. But I'm definitely interested to see how this plays out. All right, so not much else to talk about in the early game. We can definitely take a look at my scouting and some of the mistakes I did do. So notice I went 3 on wood, should have been 4. So builder mistakes there. And my scouting definitely was not the best. And the reason is I lured a deer. And I want to really highlight this fact, like if you see top players luring deer a lot, it's not always a good thing. Like with a strategy like this, I don't need the deer. I don't need the extra food. I need the scouting information to know where to attack. But because I was a minute late because I lured a deer, my scouting is going to suffer. And it's just a mistake. It's just a flat out mistake. So again, especially playing on stream, top players tend to make a lot of mistakes. I probably make one of the most, I'm probably the player that makes like the most mistakes just because I'm not really paying attention, I'm not really thinking it through. But I definitely want to clarify that these are mistakes and not just things that we do differently. Deer luring could be good to get you a food boost, but not strategies that involve you attacking fast and needing to do damage. All right, so I'm going to be going up at 21 pop here. Definitely not bad. Again, 22 pop definitely works fine. Probably even better because you don't need to attack fast with this attack. You just need to attack with a good amount of army, which is 4 men at arms plus 4 vills plus good economy at home because you're mining a lot of stone. Notice I don't have any gold. I go straight to stone. You want to go to stone a little bit earlier than your standard tower rush because you actually need to mine the gold. Like you need to mine stone early so you get gold early to be able to afford men at arms. So it's a very unique build. It's very nice. The only stone mining pulls men at arms tower rush, and the follow up for it is simply just crazy just because of how much stone you've gathered and the castles that you can afford in the castle age. So I personally really like this build, and I'm excited to showcase the rest of this game because it is a pretty banger one. So yeah, I go 4 on stone. Typical tower rush, you always go 4 on stone, so that's good for your towers, but this one also gets you good gold income. So as you can see, I'm able to afford my militia. I'm going across the map, and again, it must be noted, by the way, I do lose my scout because he gets the fuel lace faster. So that deer that I lured cost me a lot. It lost me the scout. And we're actually seeing MBL going for the 2TC boom here with the Cumans. So one thing I guess I can criticize here is that he did a second TC near the lumber camp. I think you should make it elsewhere, like here. Just you get like this wood when the lumber camp, and then this TC can collect you from this wood. You just kind of expand your economy a little bit. And he's going super greedy. Like he's also luring deer. So he's not scouting this coming. So he's playing super, super passive, super greedy. And if I have any kind of like attack coming, it's going to punish him quite hard. So unfortunately for him, that is coming, and he's gonna have to improvise. It's not like guaranteed that he's gonna take damage, but he definitely has to improvise and be quick on his toes. So we'll see how that plays out. Okay, men at arm coming in now. I do attack with only 3, and I'm trickling them in. Should be 4, but again, I messed up the build, and it's not as powerful. So I do apologize for that. But yeah, the idea is the same. So I'm gonna go for any kind of resource that I can hit that he's taking. It's very important to tower rush what he's taking. So I see that he's taking this wood. We'll go to my fog of war because that's very important here. I do the first one in line with the in range of the TC, so I drop it back a tile just to annoy him. And I'm going to hit this wood. I want to also hit the berries eventually. So those are the two resources I want to hit because the gold he's not really using for now. So there's no point of towering his gold. I don't really care about that. Anyways, I see him overreacting completely here. He sends like 10 villagers to chase me. I don't commit to it. I just leave. If your opponent overcommits like this, just let him do that. It doesn't really matter. However, you know, if he does decide to just let you have the tower or only sends a few villas, then fight him. You got to make that call. So if he underreacts, you fight. If he overreacts, you just run. And I'm going to get a tower behind his wood line here. He stopped building. I don't know why. But I'm also looking to do more damage with these 3 villas. So I left, but I'm not leaving forever. Back home, how does my economy look like? Farms around the full work. That's one of the pulls bonuses. Mining the stone, not really taking too much on the wood. I don't really care about that. I have no eco upgrades because they're not very important. Remember, the eco that I'm getting with pulls does not come from eco upgrades. It's coming from simply the amount of stone I'm gathering that gives me gold and from the full work itself. So it's definitely very solid on that front. Anyways, gonna go ahead and counter tower here, which is definitely a good choice from my main tower. Definitely not a bad option. And he's gonna once again overreact, so I once again don't fight. Again, it's very important. And he is getting ability because he's on two TCs. But if you take a look at the idle TC time, it's starting to gather. Starting to go up because he doesn't have a lot of farms. Because I've disrupted him quite a lot. So tower behind the wood line. Tower here forced a lot of idle time, pushing him off that wood. A lot of things not going his way here. Now I'm hitting the berries. Managed to kill a vill. And I'm going here with the villagers as well to try and get more towers and more damage as well. So definitely looking very good. This one is a little bit of a tragedy. So he gets caught up in the wrong neighborhood here and he's going to get taken down. It was not too happy about that, safe to say. And you're just going to use the men-at-arms to kind of hit this villager and defend this tower. And again, I think he underreacted here. Only a few vills, kind of in the middle of nowhere. I'm going to fight it. I'm going to kill a vill. His men-at-arms are very, very strong. Like, one men-at-arm is kind of equal. Like, two men-at-arms equals three vills. That's a general number that you can do. So, three men-at-arms equals, like, let's say, four vills. Generally speaking. All right, I'm going to kill the mill as well. So, as you can see, I've done a fair amount of damage here. I didn't kill a ton of vills. I killed only two. But I've done a fair amount of damage in general. I've actually killed three KD for the eco. So, I've killed three vills. But nothing too crazy happened. I think I killed one on the wood line. And I'm once again going to abandon this tower. So as you can see, it's simple. If the guy just defends, you don't have to commit to every tower. It's not a huge investment. And then back home, I'm mining more stone. Full work is filled with farms. I even make a second one. I made three farms around the TC. I actually think this is a mistake. I feel like you should just never farm around the TC unless you need to with pulls. Really take advantage of the full work because they're huge. Like, this is what? This is six farms. Seven farms around the full work, and I got 17.5 because I don't have horse collar. So 17.5 times seven free food because I farmed around a full work. Like, that's a really good bonus. Another casualty bites the dust. This TC hit got two kills, and I'm just trying to be more and more annoying. So definitely not too much happening right now. As far as follow up now, I have a few options. I can either go with a stable, like a knight, a couple knights play. That could be not bad. And I can also just be going for some forward castle once I get the castleage. So I'm going to buy my way up now. I got a market down. I've got my stable coming down as well. This is mainly just for the second building, but I do make it to have the option of going for some knights as well. So definitely a little bit of a two-purpose thing there. Multi-purpose stable. Skipping out on the blacksmith because it's not not very important. Don't really need to get fletching. I do think getting a blacksmith early is not bad though, because like the fletching option could be really good, and just in general having that second building is important. But again, not too important in this kind of game. All right, so this villager running around. Again, I don't find too much damage, but I'm up the castleage way faster than MBL. And in fact, this is like a really good time, generally speaking. Like, to do four vills forward plus 5 men-at-arms plus getting castle within like 21 minutes. That's a crazy time. Not a lot of civs can do that, really. And so definitely making use of the pole economy bonus here and the market a little bit. And MBL went for 2 TC, so he's very far behind now, still stuck in the feudal age, despite him having the vill lead. And I'm going to look to punish him. Now, a general rule, if your opponent is ahead of you economically, you want to 1 TC push him or all in him. This is especially true with a civ like Poles, who just excel at getting map control with the strategy and then dropping castles in your opponent's face because you have so much stone that you've mined. And again, haven't even touched my main gold. I'm saving it for later. Haven't touched the main gold. All right, so villagers coming forward. I'm going to go for a forward castle here. And I've decided on the location, so I have a few options. Either I can come from this hill and attack the TC and the tower. I actually didn't consider that. I was greedy. I went to put a castle here to hit both TCs and the tower. I was like, yo, that castle's insane. If that goes up, that's like fantastic. So that's what I had in mind here. Let's see if I can manage it. Otherwise, I think going for a castle here would have been better for me, like 100%. And I did scout it, so I have no excuse. Like here, castle here, control the stone, control the hill, kill one TC and a tower. That's really good. I just had to go for this one. Like, this is like a massive TC. I also pick up fletching to really... that's a massive castle. I pick up fletching as well soon, just to help the castle have extra range, because I really want to control his map with the castle. And I start dropping it down. I've got 10 villagers, 5 men at arms, and immediate reaction from MBL. Goes for a couple towers. He doesn't want to let this go down, of course, so he's doing the best he can to try and deny it. We'll see how this one plays out. And he's even sending more vills forward. And as you can see, it's not going to be too pretty for me. He's going to get some really, really nice plays there. Getting more towers down. And it looks like I can kind of get that up though. 77%, 80%. My men at arms are blocking the bills. 85%. There's three towers now potentially hitting. The TC was hitting a little bit as well. And my bills are going down, so the castle doesn't go up at 91%. Pretty unfortunate situation. I do bring in the knights though, as I said earlier, those were an option. I kill some of his bills as well, so it's not terrible, but this is definitely just a losing position for me. I'm desperately trying to get it up now because it's 91%, and if I get this castle, I basically win the game. But if I don't get it, I basically lose the game. So it's really important that I get this castle down now. And I'm actually sending more vills to commit to it. Meanwhile, I've got enough stone for another castle because I've been mining stone this whole time. And I'm also getting gold to invest into knights. So like, notice how with poles, you can invest, like, you can invest so much into stone and have enough resources to do everything else at the same time. It's really good for that use, and it's definitely just a solid option in general to go for this kind of aggressive castle play. So I decided I can't get this one, so I'm gonna go for another castle here. In hindsight, I think that should have been a little bit closer. I just had to stop and wait because I don't want to invest too much into it and get another denied castle. I think it should have been like two tiles forward, or at least one tile forward, just to help a little bit more and maybe hit the TC a little bit more effectively, range a bit more. But I decided instead, since I didn't do like that close to his base, because I didn't want to risk another castle. Like, that's the reason I did it a bit further. But I think with the knights, I would be fine to do it closer. Anyways, this is more of like a small thing. But I decided to just pick up Bodkin just to make sure I can range it. My plan: get this castle. Now there's Bodkin coming in. Get this castle, break the wall, get this castle up. Because if I can get this castle up, it ranges both TCs, all the towers, and everything. NBL's investing into rams. He's walled in this castle. He's walled here, so I can't send vills in. And his strategy is to kill this castle, make his way to Castleage eventually, and be able to push me back with a better economy. And if he holds, he can be in a pretty good position. Me, on the other hand, gonna get some knights in. I wanna go kill that ram. I wanna also, at the same time, while I'm going to kill that ram, go inside here and try to get the castle up with my vills. So I've got very ambitious plans here. My knights passed a bit weirdly, but I managed to actually pick up the ram just to slow down my castle from dying, because it's at 2k HP now, despite it being only 7% away from completion. This tower will go down because of this castle. It also helps at killing some of the vills that he might have to defend. And I'm able to get the gate down soon and build the castle. I think that guy's building it. Yeah, that guy's building it from the corner here. And he's going to be able to get that castle up. What a beast. Beast of a vill. And it's on fire, but it doesn't matter. Now I've got two castles. They have Bodkin Arrow. I've got a few knights. And, like, it's insane. I can afford another castle, guys. This strategy is absolutely bonkers. I highly recommend, if you like aggressive play, if you like to go into your opponent's face, if you hate walls like me, this is a strategy for you. It's so effective, and it's so overwhelming. And the win condition is so easy. It's so obvious. Just forward castle. Once you get a fast castle, you just forward castle your opponent, and you basically just win the game, because it's so hard to stop forward castles, especially for someone who's in feudal age. He's getting a couple rams out. He's pretty desperate at this point. He's got the vills fighting. Murder holes would be nice here. I think the 12-year-olds back in the day that used to play Age of Empires, me included, used to love murder holes. Would be good now as well, but obviously it's not really viable, because making university, getting the upgrade, it's just too long, so I'm forced to just make some units, keep him off my base. And at this point, he's pretty dead. He's losing like 20 vills. He's getting a tower at the base of my castle. And he gets the GG well played. I'm going to hit him with the GG as well. And not a bad game, man. Back home, my economy is very low. I just have some farms around the Fulwark. I invested everything forward. I've got lower vills, but I've got the map control. And that is what matters. That's how you win a game of Age of Empires. Let's go ahead and take a look at the stats here. Gonna quickly go through them, military economy, all that stuff, and yeah, more bills for him, but it doesn't matter. And subscribe to my YouTube so I can afford CapturageBlow, which is €5. All right, thanks for watching, everyone. I'll catch you guys in the next episode. Peace.